But I think this is part two of what I started, part one, I believe it was 2012. In 2012, I spoke to this group, or many of you in this group, about a new way of looking at the disease of multiple sclerosis. And as I mentioned then, this is not just a disease of walking, because that's how we think of it, right? People are in wheelchairs. This is a disease that affects their mood, their level of depression or not depression, their cognition, sleep problems, visual problems, lots of problems that are what I call hidden disabilities. And for many years, we had a research center here at the university in which we actually delved into the disease and came up with a lot of that information. So that takes us to today. And today I'm not going to talk about what MS is. I'm going to talk about how we, in the late part of the last century, late 1990s, decided to try stem cell transplants on people with MS. So let me comment about what stem cells are. Every organ in your body started out with an organ-specific stem cell. So there were liver stem cells, there were kidney stem cells, and so forth. Of course, prior to that, as a fetus, there are fetal stem cells. And those fetal stem cells can develop into any organ in the body and will develop into different organs in the body. So going back from any particular organ, you have a stem cell that's specific for that, and then you go back to that and you have the fetal stem cells, which can go in all directions. Stem cells are used, the term stem cell is used a lot. And usually it's in some circles, stem cell research is something people frown upon because the idea is, well, you have to take it from the fetus. No, the kind of stem cells I'm going to talk about today are very specific to the blood-forming organs, and I have a slide to show that a little later. So we're going to talk about stem cells taken from the patient with MS. And it's important to specify from that patient, because if the patient with MS receives stem cells from somebody else, either the stem cells would reject the patient or the patient would reject the stem cells. So we take them from the patient that we're treating, and the reason we do this is because we're going to treat this patient with very heavy medicines, which wipes out their blood system, and their blood system is, of course, what they need to survive, and the immune system is part of the blood system. So that's what we're talking about, what we call adult autologous stem cells. That means stem cells, blood stem cells from the patient. So this slide, I showed you the other end. So why think as time goes on, we're going to find out that really there are more than that. So we have a situation where we're dealing now with disease or diseases that all look like MS and call it MS. So this is important because currently we have 15 drugs for this disease, 15 we call disease modifying treatments that will modify the disease. But none of these 15 DMTs, disease modifying treatments, none of them are 100% successful. Even the newest are about 70%, maybe 80% successful. And these drugs started out, the first drug that came on the market was a very generalized drug, an interferon, non-specific to a cell type. And this disease, interferon, came on the market in 1993. It was the first drug we had that actually would suppress the progression, reduce the progression of MS. Subsequently, the drugs have improved, and they've now gotten up to 78% effectiveness. The first drug I mentioned, the interferon, is about 30 to 40% effective. So they doubled their effectiveness, but you can never seem to get this. It's a ceiling bumping up against. And I personally and others think that the reason we're bumping up against this ceiling is because these drugs are specifically tailored to attack certain cells. But if we don't know whether it's the T cells or the B cells or maybe some other cells that are causing the disease, how do we know which drug to put patients on? And right now, there is no way to really tell clinically. You could do things like brain biopsies, but that is not a very practical way of managing this disease. In fact, some of the research we're doing right now is to look at clinical tests of different types so that we can be able to know which medication to use and have more effectiveness. So that brings up the importance of the stem cell treatment that we first started in 1998, because I like to think of the stem cell treatment as a sledgehammer. You know, you maybe have a fly flying around the room, or you may have a bee or some other wasp or something, and you want to kill it, and you have a wasp killer and a bee killer and a fly killer and a spider killer. You don't know which to use. So the sledgehammer is going to wipe them all out, right? That's the best way to think of the stem cell treatment of MS. And that's why I think we've always been so effective on it, and actually improving the effectiveness and trying to reduce the toxicity of it. Because it is a sledgehammer. It attacks all of the blood cells, all of them. Doesn't matter which one is causing the problem, and it wipes them all out. But that is a consequence of therapy we're all looking at. So how can we treat MS? Consider we don't prove the pathophysiologic mechanism. And I would say, well, this is like that. Really, what you can do right now, until we can figure out which specific type of drug. Now, this may be the slide that's not working. You get a slide there? So, I'm going to jump over it. Must not be important.
It's titled Hypothesis.
I got it. This is better. Pictures, anyone? Words don't turn me on. Pictures. That was some words describing some pictures. So, this is the mechanism of MS in the general term. MS requires some. In the patient with MS, that patient has some sort of genetic predisposition to get the disease. So there has to be a genetic component before a patient gets the disease. building form vitamin D and maybe other components that are necessary to move plankton. Because we know that the further north you go, the more likely it is to get MS. Further south you go, the less likely. Between Seattle and Los Angeles, which isn't all that far, it's a kind of a 3-to-1 situation. MS is 3 times more common here than in Los Angeles. And the likelihood of getting the disease is not where you live when you get it. The diagnosis comes way after you've acquired the disease. This is where you spent your first 15 years of life. So someone who has lived in Seattle, born in Seattle, and moved to Los Angeles after they're 15 will have 3 times the chance of getting MS as somebody who lives in Los Angeles, and vice versa. So Mary's protected. So she grew up in Pasadena. Mm-hmm. So there has to be this environmental component. It also, by the way, may be certain viruses or virus combinations. Genetic predisposition, something in the environment, which then is communicated, that alters the immune system. And the immune system sees something in the environment that they interpret as something bad, like a virus or something. And they will then attack the nervous system in the spinal cord and in the brain. So this is the cause, this is the mediation, and this is the outcome. It'll take myelin, which is what coats the nerves in the brain and spinal cord, and damages that myelin. That's the essence of MS. So using a sledgehammer, you're going to sever this link. And we call this high-dose immunosuppressive therapy. We use 3 mechanisms to wipe out the immune system in people, these people with MS. We use total body irradiation, which you know is very toxic, kills tissue. We use immunotherapy, which meant we had antibodies we gave these people that could attack their immune cells. And we had chemotherapy, very high doses of chemotherapy. That's what we did in 1998. We don't do that now. It's exceedingly toxic. And we realized that we don't need all that. We can do it with less. But that's the concept. We use something to suppress the immune system, and we're suppressing the link. We're doing nothing about the genetic stuff, about the environment, but we're suppressing this link. Make sense? Now this is, I mentioned I'd come back to blood stem cells. This is the blood stem cell. It can develop into all of these cells. The white blood cells, red blood cells, lymphocytes, T lymphocytes, B lymphocytes, other cells. It can develop into a whole range of necessary cells. So if we give this patient who has this disease huge doses of immunosuppression, we're going to need to restore their immune system because that's going to be wiped out too. Now, how are we going to do it safely? Well, this is where some very clever people at the Fred Cancer Center have worked with us to come up with an answer. You've heard the term bone marrow transplant, right? Bone marrow transplant is basically a blood stem cell transplant. Why? Because the blood cells, this blood stem cells, are formed in the marrow of the bone. Mostly in the large bones of the upper part of the hips and legs, and the sternum, to the back of the bone. 70 or 80 sticks with this needle into the bone marrow, in the sternum and in the hips, to suck out enough blood stem cells to work. Very painful. Can you imagine?
No.
You can imagine. No. It was pain. And it had to be done over several days. It was a big, big, big deal. But it was the only way to get these stem cells. This is what Dr. Thomas did back when he first did his process. So you take the, you harvest the blood stem cells, and you can freeze them close to absolute zero, very, very deep freeze, very quickly freeze them. And some of the cells will die, but most will survive, and you can thaw them out and go back to the patient. The beauty of this is that the stem cell, the blood stem cell, has not been programmed to attack the myelin, the coating of the nerve. The stem cells are, we call naive. They are friendly helpers. They haven't been converted by whatever this environmental factor is. They have not been programmed to attack. So they are perfect to give back to the patient. As I said, because they're from the patient, they're not going to be rejected. So this was a very crude way of first getting stem cells. But it also meant that this was not a very popular treatment. And you know, it was a rather complex treatment. So a better way was developed. And this is this clever way that, again, I give credit to the Cancer Center for this. They developed a machine, this machine, that would be able to pull blood stem cells out once they had leaked into the circulating system, blood system. So every cell in the body has a coating on the cell wall around the cell. It's a signature. It's like a signature of your check. It's individualized. It's like a fingerprint. And it has a certain antigenic signature. In other words, it has a uniqueness, and an antibody. So there's antigens on cells, and there are antibodies that attach to those antigens. They link them together. Okay. And blood stem cells have a certain antigenic fingerprint, and so what the researchers at the Hutch did is they took these antibodies to those antigens and they attached them to little metal beads. So you had a bead and an antibody on it. And they discovered a chemical that when injected into a patient made that patient spill all of their blood stem cells out from their bone marrow and circulate in the blood. You hook this patient up for this, it's just like a blood transfusion, a reverse one, and their blood, this person's blood, goes through this machine. Meanwhile, you've got this little bead, antigen and antibody, floating through this, and guess what? They put a magnet in there. The magnet pulls out the metal bead. Attached to that will be is the antigen, the antibody. And you can do this for maybe 4, 5, 6 hours. And you collected about a fistful of stem cells, blood stem cells. Amazing. So now you need to just put it through a bath that gets rid of the metal bead and the antibody, and you've got something that works really well. That's the essence. Thank you. I have this here too. Thanks. Thank you. So, that's the technique, and that's what we do now. And I don't know what I can't read, isn't that strange? So, this is simply an example of this 5-year follow-up of the most recent group of patients we tried. This is from the 3-year follow-up of these same patients. And all these lines represent a patient and whether they did better or worse. So if a line comes over here, it means they did better than before the transplant. And if it goes over here, it meant they did worse. So if you look and see the majority of patients either are neutral or have done quite a bit better. So bottom line is patients who have done this are, this is our 3-year, we've got 5-year data, have either stayed, their disease has become stable, or majority have improved a little bit over that period of time. And if you look at, so this is the sort of the blood stem cell group, if you look at the toxicity versus the effectiveness, this is the most effective treatment we've got, is blood stem cell transplant, but it also has potential, it's potentially toxic because you are doing lots of things to the person's body. And, again, that's my reference, and we can't read it. It's in the JAMA Neurology, General American Medical Association Neurology, and it was in January of 2015. Google might put my name in, whatever, so it's there. Thank you very much. And I'm sorry.